16th at 5 o'clock. Roll call, please.
Councilmember Kusumoto?
Here.
Councilmember Murphy?
Here.
Councilmember Wilson? Absent. Mayor Pro Tem Edgar?
Here.
Mayor Hasselbrink?
Here. So at this time, we're going to be doing the departmental budget overview of development services and then police department. So, take it over.
Thank you, Mayor, City Council. We are going through our department overviews for fiscal year 17-18 budget, and tonight we're going to highlight Police Department and Development Services Director, Development Services Department. Development Services will go first, followed by Police, and the Admin Services Director, Jason Alamo, give a brief introduction.
And first, let me backtrack real quick. We need to open up for public comments.
Yes.
So do we have any to speak? Seeing none, we're closed for public comments. And Jason, you're on.
So good evening, Mayor and members of the council. So as you know, in February, we kicked off the budget process with the budget workshop. And for fiscal year 17-18, we have a preliminary deficit of $274,000. At that time, we highlighted two potential gap closure measures. One is looking at our current vacancies for full-time and part-time employees and implementing a temporary hiring freeze, allowing us to dig in deeper and looking at really what the right size of each department should be, with the goal of first ensuring that we continue to offer the same level of services that our residents and businesses deserve, and but looking for ways to operate efficiently and to potentially save the city money into the long term. And so what we've done with these budget overviews is each department has identified where those vacancies are in an effort to show how it will impact the department, but also show how we will continue to provide the same level of service. We're also in the process of undergoing a request for proposal for a consultant to analyze the organizational structure of development services and recreation and community services to look at those vacancies and to offer an independent perspective on how to deal with those vacancies, how to operate efficiently. And so we'll be bringing back an item to you, most likely in June, with an award, a recommendation for an award. And then the work for that study would begin thereafter. I also wanted to highlight that the general fund budget that we're reviewing tonight is really just the operating budget. So we're planning to bring forward the capital improvement program budget to the council on May 1st. Which is a special budget workshop, and that'll be at 5 o'clock on May 1st. And on May 15th, we will also have a budget workshop prior to the regular council meeting, which we will be going over the fee study results that we recently completed. And so we'll be bringing that to the council in May. So with that, I will turn it over to Stephen Mendoza.
Thank you, Jason. Development Services has two arms, Community Development and Public Works. The easiest way to remember it is Community Development deals with your private property in the city, and Public Works deals with the public property of the city. For your own home, it's from the sidewalk out to the street, it's Public Works. From your sidewalk into your home, it is Community Development, specifically planning in the building department. Many of the functions that we operate in our community development department is economic development, streets, building, zoning, safety, maintenance of city facilities, NPDS, which is storm drain management, making sure things don't get to the ocean, code enforcement, and we're also liaison to both the Traffic Commission and to the Planning Commission. Our department budget, you'll see a four-year view of our department budget showing different positions. You'll see the current vacancies in the public works superintendent, one maintenance worker, and one mechanic position. Those are the current vacancies, and this is the historical highs and lows of staffing in the two divisions combined. One of the things that Jason and Brett have talked about are the study that we'll go on to see what the right size of our organization is. We'll hire a consultant to take a look at public works and do an analysis of what a city this size, with this many parks, with this many streetlights, with this many miles of streets, with this many sidewalks, should have in the staffing. They'll also be able to take a look at what should be done by our guys and what should be done by consultants. Should our guys drop everything and replace the sidewalk, or should we have on-call sidewalk guys to do those kind of things on an annual basis? So we'll get a really good look at that. Until that time, we have a tactical approach of replacing some of the functions of these. Like, we have a small turn contract for a on-site auto repair facility that comes in and does what we call mobile maintenance. They do the preventive maintenance of the police vehicles and all of the vehicles right now. We'll be working on that permanent solution in the next couple of weeks for that. And then our public works superintendent, who used to do inspections of people digging in our streets, we're now performing that with a consultant under the contract with Wildan. So Wildan does that. One of the things that we'll gravitate towards in the future on the public works inspecting side is we'll probably start elevating or increasing the amount of our public works projects to include the cost of inspection in it, so we won't have an in-house person doing that in the future. So those are the tactical approaches that'll get us through to the part where we'll have the solution represented in the study. Division overview, as you know, the city community development establishes a long-range vision for the city while maintaining the mechanisms to guide the physical development, promote livability, aesthetic value, and economic development. The division structure, again, is myself, the director. We have an associate planner in community development and a secretary. That secretary you'll see in two different spots, both under public works side and community development side. We have two part-time code enforcement officers doing the work in the city. We have one building official done through a contract, and then we have one volunteer intern. We don't know how long we're going to keep that volunteer intern, but she's doing a really great job helping us out. This is the organizational chart of that division. And again, some of the functions that we have in the division is administration, planning, neighborhood preservation, building and safety, and NPDS. Again, NPDS is the storm drain management. We also serve as liaison to the Planning Commission, and here are your planning commissioners. Administration is the arm of community development that is responsible for the business environment, retention, expansion of businesses, business retention, and again, attraction as well, and city-sponsored initiatives and programs. So you'll see that this is pretty flat over this year compared to next year. No major increases there. The planning division is operated by Mr. Tom Oliver. He issued 139 zoning permits last year, 7 special event permits, 1 zoning amendment, 15 conditional use permits, 6 site plan reviews, and 1 general plan amendment, and achieved $135,000 in grants. These are some of the projects that Tom works on, a lot of these 4-plexes and 5-plexes that are going on in the city these days. Neighborhood preservation is also known as code enforcement. Code enforcement helps maintain our property values and keep the city safe and clean. Some of the caseload you'll see at 377 total cases, everything from property maintenance to business license violation, inoperable vehicles, and overgrown vegetation. You'll see this is relatively flat as well. Building and safety is done on a contract basis. That's Charles Abbott and Associates that we consult with. They do they run the counter from 7:30 to 10 in the morning, and after 10 o'clock, that same person is out there inspecting the work. So no one can get away without having a permit, because if he drives by your house, he knows he hasn't seen you at the counter. So it actually is really efficient. We 280 permits issued last year, 920 inspections, and 238 plan checks. Total valuation of construction done in the city last year is $8.6 million. You'll see that the projected is very flat. We don't. This contract is up for renewal. You'll see it on your May agenda, and they're not proposing any increase in their fees over the next year. Over the next 2 years. NPDS division, that's the division that helps manage what goes to the ocean. As you know, the sewer, that stuff gets filtered in Orange County when it goes down the sanitation district, but the stuff that drains to the ocean doesn't. So there's a lot of regulation work involved in making sure that things don't get into the storm drain system. Everything from building permits issued on a single family house, from a apartment building, from McDonald's. We even manage what McDonald's, their infiltration systems they have on their site, and we have to do annual inspections. So the funding for this is our fair, in the $66,000, is our fair share of the countywide permit. We're part of the MS4 permit, and that deals with every city from Aliso Viejo up north to us. And so we pay our percentage of that, also percentage of the watershed that works with the Coyote Creek. And then also our annual reporting is this on this as well, and then our annual business inspections. We have three different types of business inspections we do. We have high, medium, and low priority businesses that rank in those categories. Some years we have more highs than lows, and some years we do an annual inspection. And so you'll see revenue go up some years and come down some years based on the number of inspections per year. Here's where you'll see some of that reflected in the department revenues. Pretty flat from this year to next year. We are expecting the hotel permits to come in, so we had the projected plan check for the hotel to come in this year, and then you'll see the permit come in on next year. Some of the division challenges are current planning activities. Sometimes when the city calms down and you're not processing so many applications, you take a look at some of the advanced planning measures. We did the general plan when we were at a low point of activity. And then next year, it looks like we may be doing the zoning ordinance. We just went out to bid, and we've got two zoning proposals to update the zoning ordinance. And that could be one of our priorities for next year as well. We still have some zoning change to implement post-general plan. Some of the rising costs with NPDS, again, another unfunded state mandate that we are managing at our cost. So we're always concerned of the rising cost of that. And part-time versus full-time code enforcement. We have a very patient population here in Los Alamitos, so it allows us to get by with a part-time code enforcement. And so because of the patience of our constituency, we're able to get by with a part-time code enforcement. Then Public Works, as you know, I think we all can pretty much understand that they're here to take care of our facilities and our assets. They do a darn good job at it. And they manage our infrastructure, our vehicles, and our equipment. Here's a picture of the current team, minus Juan and a couple of part-time guys. Juan maintains Corey's building at night. Start off with the director, myself, and then department secretary that shares with community development. We have a superintendent position, which is vacant. We have Gary Saldivar acting as foreman. Senior maintenance workers are Victor and Anthony. Our mechanic position is vacant. We have five other maintenance workers, including one vacancy in that group. We have two part-timers, Alex and Jose. Jose does building maintenance, and Alex does field maintenance. Then we have two contractors. Both Dave Hunt is our city engineer, and then our traffic engineer is for HOD. And there's a picture of the organizational chart and all the guys. And the division functions, as you know, they manage the streets, the parks, the facilities, capital improvement, engineering services, and they're also liaison to the traffic commission. So that's for HOD and I, this is what we work on as well. So the administration of Public Works is operated by ourselves. You'll look at first glance, this budget looks like a huge increase, but it's not. It's a savings in the current year due to the vacant positions. So relatively flat in that budget area. Street maintenance is the making sure that our streets and are in good repair. Our park maintenance, our guys and our team manage a total of landscape of 30 acres. And that's between a hybrid of both of our staff and also Midori Gardens. Midori Gardens does some of our green belts down Los Al Boulevard to the south. And they also manage the green belt across Catella and manage this site. If you remember, we chose to focus our team on Coyote Creek Park in its infancy and the contracts that we have with the school district and maintaining McCullough Field. And then we turned over the other areas to the Midori Gardens, the private contractor, to do that. That was an alternative to bringing on more staffing. So it's worked out really well, and the guys are doing the work that they enjoy. And they're able to give that special care to the Coyote Creek Park and also McCullough Field. Facility maintenance, we maintain a lot of facilities and everything from pump stations to parks to bathrooms to play equipment. So custodial duties, repairs of building, pest abatement on our city property. We manage over 26,000 square feet of of facilities in our city. And our fleet maintenance, is done a hybrid of three ways. We have a mobile company that comes here to do our preventative maintenance. We have warranty work that is done on a number of vehicles that are still under warranty, and those go to Signal Hill to the dealer that we purchased them from. And then we also have the choice of our local repair garage down the street on Sausalito. So we have three different alternatives, but we still have one guy that has to manage it and get them to the location they need to be. So we're still working on that. We'll come out with a permanent solution in the next couple of months. You may see that on a future agenda item to go in a long-term mobile vehicle repair facility that'll come to our site and manage that. With that, we have a total of 32 maintained vehicles and equipment, 28 pieces of equipment. One of the things that we've done to fill in the gap is the police department has stepped up to the plate in managing their own purchasing of their vehicles, and they've done a really good job with that. They're currently out to bid on one project right now. Engineering services is done with a contract through Wildan Engineering. They issued 98 wide load permits and 114 encroachment permits. A majority of those encroachment permits this past year were for Orange County Sanitation District, as they did quite a bit of potholing in our city, getting ready for their big project that's coming up in 2 years. With that, you'll see a preliminary budget nearly flat for next year. Division challenges, of course, is getting ready for retirements and the succession planning related to those. Addressing our citywide ADA deficiencies, we did a good job about 2 years ago of having a complete inventory done of our city of all ramps, sidewalks. And as we go and repair those ramps or replace those ramps and repair those sidewalks or even just grind some of those sidewalks, we enter that into our database. So we're keeping that up to date. We've been very successful with that, and it keeps the risk manager happy. Aging facilities are always an issue in public works, so playground equipment, park restrooms, and Corey's roof is a challenge. Corey's roof got battered pretty hard during the rains, and so you may see an item come up on this in the city council sometime this year. Asset management, fleet management, public works project inspections, as I said earlier, that's being done now by Wildan. And again, limited funding for the traffic engineer. We have to rein in the traffic commission a lot. Some of their needs are hard to meet with a traffic engineer who works 7 hours a week. So we're always managing that and making sure they know the constraints within that traffic engineer's budget. So with that, we hope to bring a smile to everyone we serve. We're heavily into customer service, and we're probably the two divisions that touch the public almost as much as Corey's does and police does. We do a lot of work with the community. We're well known in the community. We're there to serve, and we want to keep that going. And we appreciate all the support the council has given us over the years to do it. With that, I'll turn it over to the police chief.
Thank you. Can I ask a question real quick?
Sure.
When you made the comment about the traffic commission,
mm-hmm.
And the potential short staffing,
mm-hmm.
we have an item tonight on the agenda to talk about expanding the parking for the traffic commission.
Yeah, expanding their authority, right.
So do you have any concern that we may expand authority to a commission that drives staff work that we can't support right now?
I do, but I have $50,000 I have to work with, and I just have to do a better job of reminding the commission of the constraints we have to work
okay.
with.
I just wanted to get that data point for later today.
Yeah.
Thank you. The other thing is, do we have an aging for the community preservation issues that 350 or 377 that you showed up above of how long those have been out there? Kind of the
caseload on the community on code enforcement?
Yeah.
Yeah, most of them are tackled fairly quickly. Most of our code enforcement issues are done with a notice of violation. A notice of violation is a 10-day freebie for you to cure the violation and get back to us. We're not real heavy-handed. We're not big ticketers in code enforcement. You won't see someone get a ticket first.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see a notice of violation. We ask you to kind of cooperate, go down the line with us, and we rarely prosecute anything. This is the one case on Paseo Bonita is the first time we've used a city prosecutor in 7 years
mm-hmm.
for a code enforcement case. So it's very rare for us to have to go to a city prosecutor. So we're able to cure those things fairly reasonable on a lower level.
Okay. It's just interesting, out of all the years I've been on, it's always been about 300 to 350 mm-hmm. every year.
Yeah.
So it's just wondering if you guys just never cleared those ones 10 years ago.
No, we, you know, a lot of the cases are stuff we actually start a case on and we don't get heavily involved in because we realize it's not within our scope. Okay. If somebody's complaining about mold in an apartment building, we're not mold experts.
Yeah.
So we'll pull ourselves out of that and we'll do a little bit of case management with the, and proper and refereeing between a complainant and a property owner, but we won't really get ourselves into testing for lead or testing for those kind of things because we're not authorized testers. So we and the trash can issue, when you have graffiti on a trash can, it's a phone call to Republic. Those kind of things are easily cured. So the longer you're here in the city, the more relationships you have. I'm able to cure things with a phone call because I know these property owners, have dealt with the property owners before, or I'll call a local realtor, say, hey, do you know who's managing that house that's vacant? And you're able to get something a little bit faster. So the longer we're here, the more tools we have to remedy some of these issues, and they don't always end up in court the way some cities do.
Great. Thank you, Steve.
Any other questions for Stephen while we're on the topic? All right, you're up.
All right. Thank you, Mayor. City Council. This is your police department, and this is our mission. And as you might expect, it really is about us creating the kind of partnerships to help problem solve the various problems, not only crime problems, but really the quality of life issues that face all of us. And we do this and with because of the level of training that we're required to have and through the state that's mandated. We also know that there's other training that benefits us to maintain the professionalism in our profession, as well as to give our officers a bit of the edge, if you will, tactically speaking. This is our org chart, and it's not a true org chart because it's really kind of a hybrid. It's both org and function. So it looks like there's a lot of people there. There are the same 30, you know, folks that you have, 20, you know, seven folks that you have, but there's a lot of things that they do. We wear a lot of hats, and I know that you're aware of that. At a small city, everybody has to pull their weight and several functions besides their primary function, whatever that is. And for us, you know, the primary function is going to be patrol, but this is an overview of our whole department. We have 25 sworn officers. Because of the budget deficit or structural deficit, we're looking at keeping one of those positions vacant, which is our corporal position. It's a quasi-supervisory position, and it's one where we believe that we can maintain the same level of service, and the citizens won't be impacted by that at this point. We have three full-time professional staff, and we have a number of part-time folks, and we're looking at reducing the hours of those part-time folks so that we reduce a half a FTE. If you look at the overall cost of it, it has gone up a little bit, 5.4%, but that is really a lot of that has to do with our MOU contracts, our the merit increases that would normally be seen, and some of the changes I believe we talked about it with the retirements from the previous chief that was here and now that I'm here and fully actualizing that benefit or realizing. This right here is our staffing matrix from 2013 to 2018. What you'll see in this staffing matrix, and I think it'll help resolve any kind of maybe concern, is that what we have on actuals, the actuals are 26 in 2013-14, then you'll see 25 full-time employees, 25 and 26. What we're actually, by not filling that vacancy of the corporal position, we have 27. And at fully staffed, you can see by the later slides that we're actually very productive right now. Even with the one vacancy, we're doing pretty well. I see we have the correction on that last one too. That's perfect. And this is the administration, or what we typically call the administration, is myself, along with the two captains and the department secretary, Captain Howard.
This is a little bit of what I do. Obviously, I oversee of the administrative support, the policies and procedures we have in place, also maintain professional standards. That also means internal affairs investigations or personnel investigations. I deal with public complaints and discipline regarding those complaints if it's warranted, and make sure that we maintain department training, as I spoke about earlier, and any of the public records requests that we have ongoing. And these are the various, are the two divisions that we have in our department. It's broken down into basic divisions. One is the most visible, which is operations, which is pretty much everybody you see in those police uniforms, works for our Captain Rick Moore up there. And then he's also in charge of our emergency preparedness, as well as our youth services, which is our school resource officer, and oversees our photo enforcement program, as well as personnel training, and of course, the dreaded parking enforcement for those who don't obey our parking laws. And then we have support services, which is what I refer to as the business of running the business of a police department, which is Captain Sean Connolly. Besides the business, he also oversees our investigations and our records and evidence bureau, which they really do a lot of work in that, and with records, as well as our investigations and communications and technology. And we'll talk a little bit about that with our CAD RMS system that we're implementing now. But we're doing, he coordinates with our facilities issues and our fleet issues. As you've heard, we've taken a little bit of a role in the procurement of our new fleet vehicles, and we'll do whatever we need to do to help, you know, try to make ends meet here. He's involved in our community outreach, as well as the fiscal part, which is the budgets, the grants, and the contracts. And lastly, he's oversees our animal contract for animal control services. Our patrol is comprised of four sergeants, four corporals. One is going to be kept vacant, so we're operating with eight officers. In this is a little bit of our patrol activity. Obviously, we're first response units. We go to, when you call 911, those are the guys that are going to get there, the guys and gals. But they also do ancillary assignments that I'm proud of. And I'm proud of it for many ways, because one of the things is, when you're a small agency, that's one of the drawbacks, is that you don't have a lot of ancillary assignments or responsibilities. And we do actually offer a great deal of things for our agents. We have three what they call SWAT operators. We're part of the West County Regional SWAT team. And we have a sergeant and two officers on that team. There's a big trickle down for that, because what they do is they're able to provide the tactical information that they glean from their SWAT training and give that to the regular patrol officers, who are going to do searching of buildings and cars and making it much safer for them, and also for the folks that might be in those buildings. We have a crisis negotiation team, which is comprised of one negotiator, and that's Corporal Smith. We have a homeless liaison officer. You're seeing that more and more with police departments that are having homeless liaison programs and officers, and the fact that we have one is pretty outstanding, and being able to talk about that with other agency chiefs throughout the county and state. And we also have a terrorism liaison officer, which is something that was implemented years back after 9/11, and requiring us to get better information and stay current on what's going on with the terrorism front and the threats against the homeland. And we do that with the Orange County Intelligence Assessment Center, which is what we call Orange County Fusion Center, which is comprised of all the agencies plus our federal partners. And then we have our tech support team. Patrol activities, this is what I'm saying about, even though we're still one position unfilled at this point, but because we have everybody that was on the matrix that you saw in our staffing matrix actually off of training and actually out there performing their job as we would expect, our responding calls for service were 8,029, which was about 3% less than last year. But our officer initiated activity, car stops, when they see somebody looking suspicious and they stop them to talk to them, has increased, and that increase has been about, I think it was 18%. And that 80% increase led to an increase in what you see in terms of arrests. There's 425 arrests on there. I know that you've been seeing the news, and on the news they've been talking about this is the lowest level of arrests in the state of California, and there's a lot of reasons for why they believe that is happening, but not in this city. You know, we've actually shown a 29% increase, and that's, you know, partially or in part due to the amount of activity that they're out there doing, the self-initiate activity. All of that, we're still keeping our priority one calls for response times down to below 3 minutes, which is something that I think all police chiefs tout. Well, most police chiefs tout. There are other cities in our county that have a 9 minute response time to priority one. That means when you get on that phone calling 911 saying we need help now, it's going to take them up to 9 minutes to get there. And you know, I've always said, when they said, well, you know, how long is, you know, is permissible, or and what does a minute really matter? And I said, well, when you're on the other end of the phone, like I have been once when I had a child not breathing in my home waiting for paramedics, that 1 minute seems like an eternity. So 3 minutes is really nice to be under. These are amount of crime reports, incident reports that have taken, about 1,200. The people that I talked about them contacting in the field, 176 individuals. We have about 12 registrants in our city for narcotics and sexual offenses. We've had 3 call-outs last year for SWAT. All went with you know, nothing significant to report. And our use of force incidents, we've had 5. And of those 5, they've all been reviewed, looked at, and found to be within policy. And so we're doing well with all of that. Next is our area command. I'll just lightly touch on this, but our you know, it's a team-based geographic approach to solving the quality of life issues. But you know, this is kind of like what we used to call beat integrity in the old days. You'd have a beat assigned to you, and you knew everyone in your beat. Well, we're trying to recreate that now because of shift work and a lot of things that go on in law enforcement. It's hard to maintain that, and so this is a way of maintaining that. This was actually brought on by my predecessor, and I have to give a lot of credit to him for wanting to take this approach to Chief Mattern. But I believe that we are looking at it in a different way and trying to implement it so that it's actually effective for us. And like I said, I'll talk more about it, but you essentially what we have is a sergeant in every area that has at least 2 to 3 officers working for them for that area. And those areas are defined right here on this next slide. But what I would suggest is that if there are, for the public that's out there viewing this or hearing this, that they know that on Tuesday, April 25th from 6 to 7:30, we're going to have a neighborhood open house. We'll be talking about this specifically so they can see their area, know their team leaders in those areas, and I think it'll be very beneficial for them for opening those lines of communication, knowing what and when to report certain things. Moving on to investigations, we have 1 sergeant and 2 detectives, believe it or not, handling all of those crimes that have been reported. And we also have an administrative corporal that works under investigations, which is our terrorist liaison officer, also does personnel and training, and is also our emergency services coordinator that helps for disaster preparedness for the city. And we have 1 part-time police aide that handles property and evidence. And that's where we're going to show that reduction of at least a 1/4 of that FTE. They have 316 cases that were investigated. Out of those, they made 23 arrests, the Bureau did by themselves. That doesn't sound like a whole lot when you talk about 1,200 and something cases that they've actually took reports on. But you know, about 70% of the reports that we take really have zero solvability factors. There are no witnesses, no evidence, mm-hmm. and nothing to really follow up on. So what they do have to follow up on, they do a really good job in getting convictions and cases filed on these. So we're very pleased with their closure rate of the cases that they're issued. The once again, this is the personnel and training aspect of it with the corporal. I believe Corporal Stacy Smith is the one that's actually handling those, handling this area with doing all the background checks, recruitments, sworn and non-sworn, and obviously the solicitor and massage permits. And we've been doing a lot of work in that area and making sure that people are in compliance. And if there's any illicit activity going on, we're following up with that in terms of the massage parlors. We have jail inspections from three agencies that are mandatory jail inspections annually. And of course, Peace Officer Standards and Training in California is the agency that governs our training and certification. They do one audit per year. And then we have records and property. We have two record specialists, full-time personnel, and one part-time police aide, where we're taking that other 0.25 of an FTE out of to help meet that gap. These folks are very busy. They process more than 12,000 different, various different records annually. They have 48 state and federal mandated reportings. They do, they have like 63, it says, evidence discovery requests. You have discovery requests, and we have a city attorney here with us, and he knows that, you know, he'll make a discovery request or ask us for information. They're the ones that are actually getting that information for us. They have 364 cases they've helped prepare for trial that include 391 defendants. And then they also help track the over 2,000 subpoenas that we have, as well as do the fingerprinting for our employees and applicants, which there were 56 last year. The busyness of this city police department, you see at our front counter, like a lot of our front counters, I imagine, in the different departments. We had over 13,000 inquiries last year, 139 citation verifications, 125 vehicles that were released, background name checks for different employers coming in the military, looking into people. We have to provide that for them. The walk-in police services, over 2,500 of those, and people asking for copies of various reports, and we had 700 of those. Besides that, they have to stay in compliance with CLETS, FBI, and CJIS audits that are required for all the handling of the records and record inquiry that we do over different electronic systems. And the records and property managed logging, storing, and releasing property, they do a lot of that. And I'll tell you that one of the things that gets a lot of chiefs or departments in trouble right away is how they audit this and make sure that this is done correctly. You always look for guns, dope, and money. And I can tell you that one of the things that they do is they track all of this stuff very well for us, so that isn't an issue. And there's a lot of purging that has to go on as well because the court mandated purging requirements. And then we destroy 39 firearms that we seized through arrests and other search warrants that were executed. Communications technology, we do look at, as you're aware, helped to secure for us is our new CAD RMS system. And with that, we work with obviously West Cities for our dispatching, police dispatching. But our new CAD system is something that we're implementing now, and we have work teams, work groups set up that are going through each phase of that computer-aided dispatch system and record management system. But these are all the contractual maintenance issues. We said APHIS annual maintenance, live scan printing through by OC RAN. I happen to sit on the board for OC RAN, and there are a lot of other programs that they actually provide. If we're actually a beta site tester for our biometric systems that we run out in the field, where we actually identify people by fingerprints out in the field when they don't have the proper identification or we think that they're lying about that. There's more of the projects that we're working on here. One of the things I want to highlight for you is the evaluation and replacement of our mobile data computers and patrols. They're pretty aged, and with the new CAD RMS system, we're looking to push a lot more data through there. So we're looking at using our asset forfeiture as a means to help support or give it a revenue stream to procure. As with many agencies throughout the country, we're also evaluating body-worn camera systems. They're not mandated at this point. Someday, if they do get mandated, obviously, hopefully they'll mandate the funding for those. But that's obviously a cost. Storage cost is huge. And there are all kinds of implications regarding confidentiality, privacy that still have to be worked out. So it's not so bad being on the trailing end of getting involved in that. But there is some benefit to having recordings of contacts with police and the community in terms of transparency and making sure that we don't get accused of doing something we know that we didn't do. We are involved in a lot of community outreach. Now we do, our internet and social media has done really well. One thing that I've learned about social media with any business really is that if you don't maintain it, update it, people get bored, they don't look at it. It's almost worse than if you didn't have it. And we change it all the time, and they can do it on the fly. I've been very impressed. Bless you.
Thank you.
And then we have our another community outreach is our support area command awareness. Doing that area command, one of the great things that we're looking forward to doing is one of our sergeants in area command too is bringing a lot of those bicyclists that do the trick riding and all that to bring a kind of a bicycle rodeo, if you will, to bring bicycle safety to the children in there, why it's important to wear helmets and obey the laws, and perhaps even trying to get their bikes licensed so that way we have an actual number for their serial number for the bikes. If they do, in fact, get stolen, we will be able to bring it back to the rightful owner. And if it's not us, it's some other agency, we'll be able to do that. We do National Night Out that many of you have already experienced, and it's a great evening out with the multiple agencies. We've done Coffee with a Cop about four times now since I've been here, and one time we decided to go ahead and invite the Orange County Sheriff's Department along with us because of our connection with Rossmore and the Rossmore citizens frequenting the Starbucks up here off of Catella. So we thought that might be good that they get to meet some of their citizens and hear some of their concerns, some pictures of that event. And then our school resource officer is part of our youth services. The breakdown of the cost sharing, you know, obviously we pay the lion's share of that. And then Los Alamitos Unified School District has picked up 5% more for that, and Seal Beach is at 25%. Currently, Rossmore doesn't contribute to this, the county, but we do have a number of their students that obviously go to the schools here in the LAUSD School District. And this is just a, kind of a list of all the things that they do for the school resource officer. One of the things that I don't want to point, or hate to bring to your attention, but student drug evaluations, 28. That means 28 students, you know, were presumed or assumed to be under the influence of some sort of drug and having to evaluate that. We also have done 25 different threat assessments and facility presentations. This is how busy they are, over 112 investigations of all kinds of nature, from property crimes to actual physical violence. We've attended 31 of those school attendance review boards, and who better than the school resource officer that knows these kids, understands, has probably been responsible for returning them back to school on occasion. We did one drug take back at Los Alamitos High School. It was very productive, and got a lot of you know, over-the-counter drugs that would be normally disposed in regular trash or down the sink, and now we got them disposed of properly, as well as your prescription drugs. And then one of the things that we did bring back that I wanted to highlight for you was our Explorer program, been gone since 2008. We reinstated that, and I think they're going on the third meeting now, and hopefully at that meeting we'll be bringing them officially into the fold, and then shortly after that getting them all suited up and start getting them trained up and in our out there in the field so that the citizens can see them, and same with the agencies around us. Our traffic program, as you can see, is one motor officer, two part-time parking enforcement aides that are very busy, and our two photo enforcement officers that are part-time. Our crossing guard program, as you're aware, last year we outsourced that to all city management services, and they've done a great job. It's very well managed, and better than that, it's really well supervised out there, and there's a lot of risk management taken out of that while it's put into their hands. The good thing about that for us is that a lot of our, in fact, all but two of our crossing guards were taken by all city management and employed by them, and pretty much at the same spots that they were at before. And the two that didn't was because they decided they wanted to retire completely from work. And this is just a little bit of our traffic activity, the kind of moving violations that we see there. You can see how many parking citations those folks are out there writing, and that and the red light camera. These, you know, when you look at 6,152, those are people either not paying attention or have total wanton disregard for the public and running that light, and those are potential collisions, you know, and some did result in collisions. And our serious traffic accident response team, our STAR team, all the agencies, four agencies are comprised of that. You know, we had two in Los Alamitos call-outs, and we had eight altogether from the various agencies. And then our emergency response, you're aware of. We're revamping that program and getting us buying supplies for the personnel here that would have to stay here to work an event. This is a list of the kind of things that we've done already, and we're planning on doing a lot more drills and getting us really prepared for that day. And then these are estimated revenue streams, traffic fines. One of the things that is really good to see on here is our DUI cost recovery. Those DUIs are not only tragic, but they do take a lot of time and resources, and we do cost recovery analysis on that and submit it and make it part of their penalties for the people involved. And of course, our supplemental augmentation fund, public safety augmentation fund, and the SLESF, and those actually represent officers that we have working here currently by funding those officers through these grants. And in the SRO partnership, and our post reimbursement is for our training. These are special police funds. I just wanted to highlight real quickly is the BSEC, which is the Board of State and Community Corrections. We received a grant from them for $63,000 for helping with at-risk youth. We'll be able to fund some portion of our Explore program with that. So it's been a very good, it's going to be a great grant for us. And it's a one-time grant. Hopefully, if they have the money next year, we'll be able to get some of that as well. And there you have it, every hour of every day.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions?
Yes, just really quick. So, Chief, in our agenda later tonight, we're approving police car purchases for about $115,000. When you went through your budget there, would you be able to tell me what slide that would be? Because when we were talking through this is a little bit for next year, but I was just kind of curious.
I can answer that if you. So actually, the budget that we went over tonight, and even the budget last month, has completely been operating only. So our capital improvement budget for 17-18, we plan to bring forward in May. So actually, May 1st, we'll have the CIP, which will include vehicles. So the item that's on tonight's agenda was part of the CIP discussion from a year ago. And so since we haven't included any capital-related items, we've just excluded that. But the items tonight, the vehicles, were part of the Wells Fargo equipment financing. Mm-hmm. We call it a lease financing, but it's really it's a loan. There's a $1 lease purchase at the end of the term. And so those vehicles, we actually bought, we're authorized to get three in February. Tonight on the agenda, there's three more, and then there's one more to come. So there'll be seven in total. And then the total value is approximately $270,000.
Okay. I'll switch subjects. The other question I had is, you know, when you show the statistics of our 911 response time, 2 minutes, do you know what the response time is in Rossmore for the sheriff? Do you have any idea approximate?
I really don't have that information. I know that we respond for them on a number of occasions. Because they're either in Stanton or Midway City or somewhere else, and they'll call when they know that the response time is going to be over that time. They'll call us because they know that we're closest available, and we'll respond to that call and hold that scene until until they can get there.
Do those calls go towards our response time, average times, or do they get held outside for statistics?
Yeah, those, yeah, they're not, I don't believe they're our priority, they're not our priority one calls for service.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
It's just other agencies.
Do you know what time that is, though, when you're providing assistance to Rossmore?
Our response time? I don't know, I can tell you that it's probably 3 minutes or less, yeah, in almost every case.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Yes. You know, I don't want to get three tickets on the way home, but I just want to explain my disappointment with this, okay? I feel like we just got 30 minutes of filler. We got a budget of $6.185 million, and we covered that in about 3 seconds. That's 90% of what this was supposed to be about when we started. We don't have any budget numbers here, okay? And then when we show police activity, when you show me we made 9,000 stops a year ago this year, that doesn't tell me anything. I mean, was it down from 15,000 the year before? Or was it up from 100? You know, I need a 3 or 5 year chart that shows me where crime is going. These are just statistic numbers that standing alone tell me nothing. But for next year, we need half of this should be the money. You know, where's this money going? It's up, you know, it's up $300,000. Why? The rest of this I can read, but the budget is what we're here for, yet we covered everything else but the budget in the time allotted. And I would suggest next year, I know we tried to save some time, but the police, with the size of their budget, need an hour. Okay, is my personal feeling. Thank you.
Councilman, I might just comment that about 79% of that is, you know, salary and benefits. So about 21% is what we would call the M&O, or the stuff that we buy, the material, the supplies. Okay. So, you know, when we leave those vacancies, I mean, the only way we're going to get the kind of significant cost reductions is by bodies and not by less bullets or, you know, less paper and all that other stuff. Because it only, you know, that cut is very, that portion of our budget is less than 25% of our budget.
Okay, but Chief. Okay.
And the increase, I think I told that was that the increase between the amount of activity, radio calls went down for service by 3%, but our activity, our proactivity went up, you know, by 18%. The arrests went up by 29% over last year. And overall, the activity was up by 8.75%. That means that we were at, I think, 16,000, say 500 versus, you know, 17,666 incidents of activity. So it, what I was, the purpose in telling you that was to show you that that even though we're going to go ahead and keep that vacant, because the concern is if you're going to keep that vacant, are you going to be able to maintain the level of service? Well, right now it's vacant, and we are actually, our level of service has increased. You know, we've increased programming, we've increased the police activity, and fighting crime has increased. And the reflection of that, the budget itself, you know, the difference in what it was, that 5.4% that you're referring to in our budget, you know, a good portion of that is just MOUs language and merit increases for folks, as well as the difference between when you had the police chief that was here prior as an interim or working just for salary with no benefits, then bringing me on as a full-time person, you know, with not only the salary but the benefit package as well. So that increased the cost as well. That's reflected in that, because otherwise it's pretty much flat. I mean, we didn't do any increasing.
I'm not complaining about the job that's being done. I'm saying, show me.
Okay.
Okay, you know.
I understand that.
Like on page 11, patrol activity. As I'm saying, those statistics are meaningless to me when I don't know what I'm comparing them to. I don't know which way the trend is going. If the trend's in our favor, you'd think you'd want to have a slide that shows that. But my main point is, even if it is personnel and it's all contracts, let's see what departments are we. Let us look at, are we overstaffed in places, you know, in our non-professional opinion. Give us more than two lines. This of $6 million, that's roughly half the budget. And we covered it like I said, seconds, and we left ourselves 5 minutes to ask questions on $6 million worth of budgets. It's not what this is supposed to be about, okay? It's supposed to be reviewing the budget, and we're not given any information in this in this meeting today that gives us any questions of even the ability to ask questions about the budget.
If I can add something, that's actually good feedback. I appreciate that. We can work to incorporate some additional information into the PowerPoints for next year. But this is actually the third budget workshop. I think actually the one that you missed was maybe the one that would have been helpful, the one in February. I'm looking at the PowerPoint presentation in February, and so the increase in expenditures is actually $465,000. And of that amount, $497,000, so basically the entire increase in expenditures is salaries and benefits. And as we discussed in February, $115,000 of that is pension costs. It's just the amount that PERS has told us we have to pay above and beyond what we paid or will pay in 16-17. And then the additional amount is the MOU stipulated cost of living adjustment increases, merit increases, and then of course the big item is the vacancy savings. So the difference in terms of approach that we took for 17-18 was, instead of factoring in what we think we might save from vacancies and attrition, we've just budgeted full staffing. So there's a big difference in terms of our 16-17 projected amounts, which we know we're gonna have significant vacancy savings because we've already implemented a temporary hiring freeze. So we have savings in 16-17, but yet in 17-18, at least with the preliminary budget, we've budgeted full staffing. But then to get back down to a balanced budget, that's what we're recommending, the implementing and carrying on that temporary freeze to then go ahead and close the books.
Anybody else? All right, we're going to go ahead and adjourn this meeting and go into our regular meeting.